The Biden administration says it lacks the authority to share details of Moderna's vaccine process with developing countries. According to the Washington Post, White House officials cite legal reviews as a key roadblock, saying, quote, "This isn't a White House reading of the contracts. This is the expert agencies reading the contracts, including the procurement officials who have the expertise to deal with these issues all the time."
But Moderna has received a whopping $10 billion in federal funds to expand its vaccine manufacturing capacity, execute trials, and produce more shots. Team Rising is here to weigh in on the matter. Sarah Riggs Amico, former Democratic Senate candidate and former lieutenant governor candidate in Georgia. She's also the executive chairwoman of Jack Cooper Investments and founder of Our American Dreams PAC. And Rachel Bovard, director of policy at the Conservative Partnership Institute. Welcome to you both.
Good morning.
So what do you make of this, Sarah? How do you respond to what Moderna is claiming here?
Well, we have to remember a couple of things. Number one, the White House has done a very thorough legal review. I am confident they got the best available attorneys, and they're making the decision that they feel is in the best interest and in line with the law. But the other thing we have to remember is that Moderna was actually developing this mRNA technology for many years before they began to partner with the U.S. government on the COVID vaccine. In fact, they were even partnering with the U.S. government slightly before the outbreak of COVID-19 on a couple of other mRNA viral vaccines. So they certainly have the right to intellectual property. Those property rights are a key tenet of how we think about our capital markets, how we think about our rights as citizens in this country. On the other hand, the United States, if their goal is to deploy vaccines around the world, we have many, many levers we can pull, including, remember, 100 million doses of AstraZeneca vaccine right here in the United States, where they're not yet approved, but they are approved in other places, such as in Europe, in the United Kingdom. Those are ways that we can also help boost vaccination, particularly in the developing world, without violating the intellectual property rights of vaccine makers like Moderna.
I mean, and good for Moderna for doing some mRNA research, but a lot of the mRNA research was done by scientists at universities, much of that being, you know, funded by the public. There's a lot of skepticism around the vaccine from people who distrust Big Pharma, and they think that Big Pharma is just giving you this fake vaccine just to make money. But the real problem with Big Pharma isn't that their drugs don't work. The problem is often that their drugs do work, but they're not sharing them with people at affordable rates. They're hoarding them and charging, you know, eye-popping prices for it, which is what they're doing here. Rachel, how did this failure come about? Is it on the Trump administration for not negotiating a better deal that would, you know, give the United States access, to the product that it was funding the creation of? Or is it on Biden for kind of being in the pocket of pharma here? Or is it both?
I think it's probably a little bit of both. But I admit to being a little torn on this question because, you know, I do agree that, you know, a lot of the expertise that we need in situations like this is just frankly not housed in the government, right? It's in these private corporations that the government is sort of forced to do business with. And now at the same time, these vaccines would not have come to market, I don't believe, without Operation Warp Speed, right? Without the Trump administration pushing massive amounts of funding and expedited regulatory approvals to these companies. So you have this tandem here that I think does put a little of a bit of a burden on these companies to kind of show up when the country needs them. But I think, you know, back to your earlier point about the contract that the Trump administration negotiated, we have to have, I think, a better in-house perspective on how to deal with these things, because a lot of this stuff was rushed. We were dealing with a pandemic, but we need to have something in a drawer, right? The outline of how we deal with these things going forward, you know, looking ahead, being able to see that we are probably at some point going to want to bring this vaccine to market globally. How, you know, does the government leverage the funding it's providing with its future needs? We just haven't done, I think, any forward thinking on that question. So now we find ourselves in positions like this. And the last thing I'll say is you want to have that in the contract going forward, or initially, I mean, so that the companies, if they don't want the terms, can simply say no. But now we're in this position where, you know, everybody's scrambling and there's blame on all sides and we aren't really solving any problems.
Well, Sarah, I mean, there's so much to my mind, catastrophic government failure throughout the pandemic on, I mean, the testing screw-ups at the beginning were just catastrophic. The, you know, mixed messaging from the CDC, from Dr. Fauci, people like that. It makes people, I think, have good reason to lack confidence in giving the government too much control over this process.
You know, there have been many failures, and many of those did start in 2020 and even before with the Trump administration. In fact, Rachel mentioned having a plan to deal with these kind of situations. That's exactly what the Obama administration left to the Trump administration. It was summarily left in a drawer to gather dust and tossed out. It was not utilized. So we not only have to have a plan for what happens when the next pandemic arrives, we have to have a sense of civic responsibility that this shouldn't be something that's partisan. This is something that's in the best interest of the American people, of our national security, and of our economy. This has to be a moral argument that we need to do everything we can within our power. And yes, I do think Operation Warp Speed should get some credit for the development, the rapid development of a vaccine. But the Biden administration should also be given credit for the extraordinarily quick rollout, really by July 4th, having over half of the population vaccinated in this country was a remarkable feat, considering how many times we sputtered on things like testing. I remember back in the spring of 2020 when my sister was sick, she wasn't even able to procure a test. I had a daughter who was sick in the summer of 2020 and got her test results, negative test results, back 14 days after she tested, well outside of the quarantine period. So again, there have been many failures, but I think the Biden administration is doing the best that it can to recover that public confidence in our ability to execute these incredibly important public health rollouts.
And Rachel, what about the government's potential march-in rights for the patent for Moderna, Pfizer, Janssen, any of these? This intersects with your antitrust work at all. Is there an opportunity in the future for the U.S. to just kind of march in and grab the patent and say, no, it's too important that we get the entire globe vaccinated for you guys to continue hoarding this?
Yeah, it's a tough question because, again, I come back to this idea that I want companies to step up in a time of crisis and, you know, work with the government when they have the ability and the research and the technology to do so that the government doesn't have. I think if you set up a situation where the government can just come in and swipe your IP, no companies are going to work with us in the future. But there is a balance here because, again, the government does have a stake and sort of an ownership stake in what has been produced here, and they do have an overriding incentive in some public health circumstances to say, no, you need to do this. So I do think we need to think more carefully about these things going forward. I'm not as familiar with the Obama plan that Sarah mentioned, but I think we do have to have some sort of whole of government examination of how we do these things going forward, because it's not appropriate, I don't think, for it to be a binary question of one or the other when both parties have been so intimately involved with producing these vaccines.
Rachel and Sarah, thank you so much for being with us.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, guys.
And we'll have more Rising after this.